verse 1 to 6. It reads as follows. I urge you then, I who am a prisoner because I serve the Lord, live a life that measures up to the standard God set when he called you, to be always gentle, humble, and patient. Show your love by being tolerant with one another. Do your best to preserve the unity which the Spirit, by means of the peace that binds you together. St. Paul calls us to get along, even when it is hard. He says to be humble, gentle, patient, and forbearing with our fellow believers, irrespective of religious affiliation. And through our efforts to do so, God will be glorified in the world. We pursue unity because God is one. Let me put out the profile of this phrase. Meek, but not weak. Because meekness carries this idea of strength under control. Jesus was meek as he walked the earth. Yet certainly, he was not weak. He was strong and not afraid to speak the truth. He used his power gently, especially when he was around hurting people, the abused, marginalized, women and children were abused during his time. The ones he was not gentle with, like the self-righteousness or the self-righteous of the Pharisees, the custodians of the Jewish laws, needed a little truth in the face, so to speak. The question is, can you be gentle with others? Can you treat others with respect? Can you be considerate of their needs? The homeless, the killing of our young girls, university students, the safety of our women and children, can we be considerate? Can you submit your rights for their benefit? Can you serve people selflessly without expecting anything in return? Paul says to be patient. You have probably heard this prayer. God grant me patience and hurry. Or the advice, never pray for patience, because God will give you opportunities to develop that patience. The word patient carries the idea of being long-suffering or long-tempered, that you are not easily provoked. You can give people a little grace because you realize that God has given you a little grace. The question is, are you patient with others? Now, here Paul is writing to people in the body of Christ, the church, we, the church, the communities, and any other institutions, are we patient with one another? Unity does not mean uniformity. Don't expect others to be exactly like you. In conclusion, this is a form of patience. Paul says, to bear with one another in love. The idea of forbearance is to be patient, specifically with the shortcomings of others. And don't worry, God will give you to practice this. God will use people as his heavenly sandpaper to shape you in the person you need to become. As you allow him to give you forbearance, so how do you forbear with others? You remember how much God has put up with you and your shortcomings. Now, this is a very hard stuff, right? Especially around the EGR people, for extra grace required. So why bother? Why should you be humble? Why should you be gentle? Why should you be patient and forbearing? Why should you pursue unity in the church or in any other institution? The answer is because God lives in perfect unity. Paul mentioned seven great unifying principles of our faith. Three, describing the Holy Trinity. And four, describing the Christian walk in general. Since God is unified, we need to walk in unity as well. We need to live in unity. We need to build unity. We need to pursue unity in our families. We need to pursue unity in our institutions and our communities, because we are one body. We are the body of Christ, the church. As Paul said earlier in his letter, the church includes both Jews and Gentiles. The church includes every ethnicity. The church includes every skin color. The church includes every socio-economic. We are one in Jesus Christ, bound together in the cross. Amen.
That was Colonel Mukurobe. Thank you very much. In closure, it would be remiss of us not to express our gratitude first to the family for making this day possible, the president in his tight schedule, the bishop and the entire leadership of the church, leaders of various parties, yourself, the Mrs. and Mr. Party who are here, the Philharmonic, the Army, and everyone else. We're very grateful. The President has spoken. What I read from what he said is that the greatest selfishness, human selfishness that is great, feeds sustainably in the mastery of selflessness. And that's the message today, that the future of this country is a business of all of us. Having said all that, ladies and gentlemen, we have reached the end of the day with military precision. What we're going to do, first we're going to allow His Excellency, the President, and the family to leave first. And thereafter, once they have left, we follow, that being the end of the day, and wishing you the greatest day ever and the wonderful trips wherever you are going. On behalf of the organizers, I love you all. Thank you very much.
The memorial service for F.W. de Klerk, as you can see, has just ended. It ended with a prayer by the chaplain of the SANDF. People are now, guests are now moving out here. We see President Cyril Ramaphosa moving out with Mr. F.W. de Klerk's widow, Elita de Klerk. Let's just move in a little closer, sharing a few words. Over there, here the president comes, obviously mobbed by media. Okay, it's a bit of a mashup over here. So in his eulogy, we heard the president speak about the role that the former Deputy President F.W. de Klerk played in dismantling apartheid and in the transition to democracy. He again confirmed that he understands the pain and the hurt, and that people don't necessarily understand why the state decided to honor the former Deputy President in this way. But he says that in no uncertain terms can it just be written off, the role that F.W. de Klerk played during that time. He gave a few, he spoke a little bit about his own personal relationship with F.W., saying that they always had a very respectful relationship, that even though they clashed on occasion, that they were always able to be respectful in their discussions with each other, that they had a cordial relationship. He, of course, shared his condolences with the family. And what he said was very interesting at the end. He said that F.W. is and was a true son of the soil, that he was a true son of the soil. and that he is now returning to that African soil. I just want to bring in my colleague Mariska Buata. Mariska was at the scene of the protests. Obviously, I couldn't be there. Mariska was there. Mariska, thank you so much for joining us today. Just give us a little bit of an eyewitness account of what happened back there.
There were three people, two women and a gentleman who identified himself as Mr. Kasim Khan from the Imam Harun Foundation. And they said there will be no reconciliation in South Africa without justice. And they were calling on the president. It was just before the president was due to arrive to give the eulogy at the memorial, that they said the president still has time to consider not to do this. And they use an example saying that while there were funerals for anti-apartheid heroes like Ashley Creel, there were raids on churches, there were raids on people's homes, and this kind of courtesy was never afforded to them. So they're asking on the president that former cases involving the death of struggle heroes and struggle victims be reopened again. And they said without justice there can be no reconciliation. And they were then later removed by the police to another corner where they were told they are free to stand there and speak, but they were not allowed to stay right here. It's about 50 meters from where we are right now, and they didn't want them to stand there and were removed by police.
Mariska, thank you so much for your time. That was my colleague Mariska Buata, of course, giving us an eyewitness account. Behind me, I have John Steernazen. John, hi, sorry to grab you there. Hi, Glynis, hope you guys are well. I saw you coming in. What are your thoughts? We know this is a very polarizing issue. South Africans have very different opinions on who FW was to the country. Can you just give me your thoughts?
Yes, well, I think that we must use an occasion like today to recommit ourselves to the project of building a truly non-racial South Africa and the constitutional ideals that were laid down. You know, every South African politician has a different interpretation of their careers, but I think nobody will be able to deny the enormous contribution that Mr. de Klerk made in pushing forward the process of us moving towards a fully fledged democracy today. And I think that we should strive to the ideals that the constitutional framers had put in place for us to achieve.
Glynis, while I have you here, you are on the Justice Committee as well. Lots of talk about the role that the MPA is playing. Lots of controversy over the last few weeks. MPA is not moving fast enough, especially in looking into apartheid-era atrocities. Your thoughts on that?
Well, we had a meeting last week where we discussed this very issue. And the Justice Committee has made it very clear that we've run out of patience. And that all of these matters, those that are new and must be prioritized, and those that are old and must be prioritized, must get attention, and they must get attention now. We're talking about serious issues, about families that have been torn apart, about people waiting over 20 years for closure. It's time.
Glynis Breitenbach of the DA, who also serves as an MP on the Justice Committee in Parliament, and of course her leader, John Steernazen, leader of the Democratic Alliance, telling us why he thinks that today was such an important day, just basically to also acknowledge what FW did. Back to you in the studio.
Look, we heard from a number of people paying tribute to F.W. de Klerk. Jan de Klerk stands out. Some of the quotes that he was, he was going through from his father. He was saying that he lived by the motto, kindness is not a weakness. He believed that gratitude changes what you have into enough. And he also said that F.W. de Klerk always said that challenge the status quo. We heard from his wife, Alita de Klerk, heartfelt, paid tribute to her husband, her late husband, and also shared some deep love and feelings that she has for F.W. de Klerk. President Cyril Ramaphosa also, he said, He came to know F.W. de Klerk over many years during negotiations, first at CODESA and the multi-party talks, and later in the Constitutional Assembly. And they had moments of, well, friendliness, but they also had disagreements. He could be affable, but he could also be stubborn, the president said. And he also could, you know, he could prepare himself to compromise, but he was also willing to dig in his heels. And the president said that Mr. de Klerk offered him counsel. Other times, Ramaphosa offered de Klerk counsel. And there were times when strong words were exchanged between them. Yet even in moments of difficulty, at times when they were close to the brink, Ramaphosa said he found him to be courteous, respectful, and committed. The president went on to say that we can never forget the lives that were lost, the families that were torn apart, the land that was taken, the livelihoods that were destroyed, the rights that were denied, and the dreams that were dashed. He said, we can never forget the humiliation, the degradation, and the inhumanity, nor must we ever forget the responsibility that we each bear to consign such suffering and injustice of the past, or to the past. And each of us, he said, has a responsibility to help build a new nation and a new society dedicated to the realization of the potential of all. The president's words.